Hello, and welcome back to Sound Advice. I'm Shelley Broderick, Dean of the UDC David A. Clarke School of Law, and your host. Guardianship can take away people's right to make decisions about their lives, even basic choices like where to live, whether to work, what to do, and who to see. Even though study after study has shown that people with disabilities who have more control over their lives have a better quality of life, the number of adults with guardians has tripled since 1995. In the District of Columbia, 70% of people served by the Developmental Disability Administration have a guardian or a substitute decision maker. 2013, Quality Trust for Individuals with Disabilities and its legal director, Jonathan Martinis, represented a young woman with Down syndrome named Jenny Hatch, whose parents went to court to become her guardians so that they could put her in a group home against her will. After a long trial, Jenny won the right to make her own choices using a process called supported decision making. Jenny now lives and works where she wants, sees who she chooses, and encourages others to do the same through Quality Trust's Jenny Hatch Justice Project. I'm delighted to welcome to Sound Advice, Jonathan Martinis.
Thank you for having me.
I'm so glad you could be here. This is such incredibly important work. We talked before the show about the famous Evans case in which our law school, that would be the UDC David A. Clarke School of Law's predecessor school, Antioch, actually brought the case that resulted in closing Forest Haven, an institution where about 1,500 people were being, frankly, abused, neglected, warehoused, and people even died there from lack of care. And so I've cared about this incredible work for 35 years since I first came to the law school, and I'm so glad it's being carried on by an aggressive legal director like you.
Well, first, on behalf of every single person who has benefited from the Evans case, thank you to UDC Law School for starting the fight. On a personal note, and on behalf of my family, who now has a roof over its head, thank you for winning that case.
Well, it's a, you know, it was an amazing effort by literally hundreds of law students and faculty over a very, very long period of time, but it was a labor of love for sure. I've done a number of shows actually with Mr. and Mrs. Evans back in the very earliest days of this television show. They were here. And Vince Gray, of course, was a huge advocate in that case and brought us into the case back when he was at the ARC. You know, I did a show with someone with developmental disabilities, and I used the R word, and I was shaped right up. And I understand that ARC is ARC and nothing more.
That's correct. And I've got to tell you, I think it's great that you did those shows with the Evans folks and people who've been involved in this issue for so long. The overarching message, the real takeaway from Evans and from so much of the other work done by organizations like ours, like the ARC, like so many of the others, is that people with disabilities are people first. So we don't need the R word. We can just say people or folks, because people have the same rights no matter if they have disabilities or not. And that is a big part of what we do at Quality Trust, is making sure that people have the supports and services they need to live lives as people.
So, you know, I'm so glad you said that, but let's talk about what Quality Trust does, how you came into being, what is the P&A? Come on, put us in the picture. I know the lingo.
You do know the lingo, I'm impressed.
Protection and advocate?
I imagine, given your background, you know a lot more than that.
Couple
but
things.
Quality Trust, what we do, what we were formed as, is about 13 years ago, we were formed as part and parcel, a partial settlement of the Evans litigation, to create an independent entity to make sure that the district was doing what it was supposed to be doing to make sure that people with disabilities, not just the Evans class members, but all people with developmental disabilities, receive the supports and services they need, get what they need to live the quality of life, to quote the ARC, a life like yours. And that's what we do. We're part of a larger system. The P&A, University Legal Services, is a plaintiff's counsel in that case, and they have a very important part, and we hope a partner in making sure this works going forward.
It's terrific. So tell me more about Quality Trust. I think there are three branches of it?
Right. We have if you look at our job as making sure people with disabilities have the chance to live the lives they want, we have three different sections. One, which is a direct outgrowth of Evans, is the monitoring section, who is charged with, as parts of the Evans case are completed and as the Evans case itself is completed, taking over the monitoring to make sure that people with disabilities have safe and quality care and support. We have an advocacy division whose job it is to handle kind of day-to-day advocacy issues for people with disabilities. Not quite an ombudsman or clearinghouse office, but someone you can call and say, I'm having a problem with X, can you help me? I need services over here, can you help me? And we have a legal department whose job it is to provide legal representation, legal advocacy, legal support, both in individual and larger systemic issues. That's how we got involved in Ms. Hatch's case. We try to identify issues that have the greatest impact on people in DC. I mean, Jenny Hatch's case was in Virginia, but it had a direct precedential impact on people right here in D.C. on this guardianship issue. We identify those issues, we take them on, and thus far we win them.
So talk to me about some of the other kinds of cases that come into your office, and who are the people affected? And
sure. People with disabilities have a number of options when they're looking for services and supports. And through the Evans case, we know that they weren't always of the highest quality.
Right.
All credit to the district. They've made efforts to improve that as time has gone on. But we have people with developmental disabilities come to us and say, I need help finding housing. And part of our job is to help direct them toward the proper agency to seek that through, and then to advocate for them to receive appropriate services from that agency. Or
if someone's been denied a service, to
advocate for them to receive it. I'm sorry.
Well, so you're a person with a disability. Give me an example of a kind of person with a disability who would want housing and what kind of supports and advocacy they might need.
Sure, a person who qualifies for services through the district's Developmental Disabilities Administration, and they have qualifying criteria, could come to us and we could help them apply for services. And when you receive services through DDA, the Developmental Disabilities Administration, you can get access to all kinds of things, including housing support, including supported employment.
So might this be someone in a wheelchair, someone with intellectual disabilities?
Yes.
All of the above. Yeah, okay.
We were formed and we focus on people with developmental disabilities. That is an awfully broad definition.
Right.
My recommendation, if you need some help and want to get some questions answered, give us a call.
Okay.
We will either help you or find someone who can.
Okay. So somebody is maybe being denied housing. What can you do?
We can advocate for them to receive proper services, proper housing support. And
would be some of the supports that you can put in place?
For one, through DDA, supports and services to live independently, independent living services, sometimes.
What are they?
Well, you know. Training and support, assistive technology, education, sometimes funding, sometimes assistance in locating affordable housing, sometimes subsidies.
Okay.
And if someone is not getting what they need, or if they should get something and don't, we can advocate for them all the way through the original stage, through appeals.
Well, so one of the things I'm kind of trying to get to is, I suspect that there are lots of people who can live on their own with a little help. Maybe if they don't read well, somebody to help pay the bills, or somebody to help, you know, from time to time bring in repair folks. You know, I certainly know I need plenty of help with that. And it's not surprising that lots of people really can be just fine with some help. Are there those kinds of services?
Absolutely. What you're talking about is called support.
Okay.
And when we're talking in the guardianship context, I refer to supported decision making. Everybody, you said it yourself, and this should be the motto for people with disabilities or for our office. Everybody needs a little bit of help. Except that when people without disabilities say, I need a little bit of help, we're being smart. We're getting the help we need. When people with disabilities ask for help, everyone assumes they can't do anything.
Right.
So you're right. That is where the services and supports come in. And there are offices for people with developmental disabilities. I would start with the Developmental Disabilities Administration. For people who are looking for support in work service, the work arena, there is the Rehabilitative Services Administration.
So slow down, New Yorker.
I'm from New York. It's going to happen.
My job is to...
Court reporters tell me that all the time.
You know how I hate New York. Yankee fan. So I'm being the very best I can.
Bucky Dent says hi.
Okay, here comes the really, what is the square of the hypotenuse? No. So if I have disabilities and I want to work, but I don't know what kind of work I might be, you know, what's within my capacity? I don't know. You know, I haven't been in the workplace yet. Rehabilitative services will help me?
Correct, or RSA is what we call it, the Rehabilitative Services Agency. They're a subset of the Department of Disability Services. RSA exists. They are federally funded. Their sole purpose in existence is to help people with disabilities who want to work and have the ability to work maximize their employment potential. Note the word maximize.
Gotcha. So give me an example.
Absolutely. I worked with someone, an attorney in my old office. She's deaf. And when she was growing up, she applied to the Alabama version of RSA. Every state has one, and says, I would like to be an attorney. I have the ability to do it. She tested to do it. And that office said, well, it's a lot of work to be an attorney. How about we support you to be a paralegal? And she said, no, I have the ability to be an attorney. I want to be an attorney. Your job is to support people like me in maximizing our abilities. She is an attorney today. She is the managing attorney in the Georgia Protection and Advocacy System. And that's what I mean by maximize. You go to RSA here in the district, and one of the first things that you should be requesting, first thing that I always request people I work with, is a vocational evaluation.
Okay.
That is designed to do exactly what you said. Help identify your strengths, your interests, to help you begin that journey of maximizing your potential. And then, once you've identified what you want to be, with their assistance and support, they are supposed to provide the supports and services you need to reach that goal.
So, I know that we have law students and college students here at the university who get help. Note takers sometimes, mm-hmm. people with difficulty taking notes. For whatever reason, mm-hmm. we've had blind student, you know, and there are all kinds of books and materials that are available to help people get through law school.
Mm-hmm.
That kind of thing?
Yes, it certainly is something that can be provided. I applaud UDC for providing that. I think UDC has a separate obligation under the Americans with Disabilities Act to do
mm-hmm.
that,
mm-hmm.
but certainly RSA can provide similar assistance.
Well. One of our faculty members is the principal author of the Americans with Disabilities Act, Bob Bergdorf. So we like to think we've been enlightened. We've certainly been educated. And I will say this, with the best will in the world, you're not born knowing everything. And I can give you some examples. You know, we had a student in a wheelchair, and he said, you know, I can't get to the library door. The library door is open at a certain time, and you have to wheel, you know, I would have to wheel all the way around the whole giant mm-hmm. building to get into the only door that's open on weekends. So I sent an email to the chief of police on campus and said, you know, what should I do, so and so, and I named him, and I CC'd him. Well, the student got back to me and said, first of all, there's no reason for you to give my name to anyone. It doesn't matter which person this is. You have to make the building accessible to all.
Yep.
And so just, you have to open that door. Well, secondly, the chief of police said, sure, we want to be accommodating. Have him tell us what hours
Ring
he wants it's open. And he said, no.
Yep.
I may change my mind.
Mm-hmm.
You know, other law students can decide they're going to study Tuesday night and change their mind and not study Tuesday night and study Wednesday night instead. I shouldn't have to constantly report that.
I've
it should be accessible.
I've had cases like that with gas stations where they say, honk your horn, we'll come out and help. They call that honk and wait. We actually call it honk and eventually leave because no one ever comes out.
Right.
What you said is 100% correct about learning. We all have to learn. You talked about guardianship before. All these people wind up under guardianship, I think, because parents and friends don't know there are other options. They've got people who they trust saying, get guardianship. At 18, you have to have a guardian, lawyers and doctors and teachers. And parents who are stressed out as it is,
right,
don't know there are other options. So yes, that is one of the most important lessons in this or any other disability issue. Learn, understand that there are choices and there are options, because choices are what make us who we are.
Well, absolutely. So tell me more about when guardianship is appropriate or not appropriate. How do we best avail ourselves of guardianship opportunities?
Well, you have to define your terms, because guardianship's a 2,000-year-old process.
No, you have to define my terms.
You omnisciently must define, we all must define our terms, because guardianship's been around for 2,000 years. My ancestors, the Romans, came up with that idea, where typically a person with disabilities is assumed can't do anything, so we give all of their rights to somebody else to make decisions for them, often without even consulting them.
Right.
So,
and we think we're being heroes.
Right. We think we're
Heroes.
We think we're protecting the person with disability from making bad decisions. Well, I always say is if making a bad decision means you need a guardian, there's a lot of people need guardians. Exactly. I mean, have you bought a pasta maker at 2 a.m? Where's your guardian? did you read everything on your mortgage documents? No. Where's your guardian? So guardianship forever has been that protective theory. Now, what we believe in is this method called supported decision making, which does not require a guardian. It's supported decision making is a fancy term. It's the way that you and I make decisions. Think about the way you make decisions today and
every day. I'm going to buy a convertible. I know what I do. I call all the guys I know who've recently bought a car and done all the research, and then I pick their brains, and then I figure out
exactly
what they know.
You've gotten the information you need to make the best decision.
It's a Volvo convertible.
I have a Toyota MR2 Spider. I should have talked to some more people about it. But people with disabilities make decisions the same way. They might need some more information, but they can do the exact same things without the need of someone making a decision for them. We believe that people with disabilities should be making decisions with, just like you did.
Right.
Just like you did in deciding on your Volvo. So guardianship, I would tell you 99 out of 100 times isn't necessary. We don't need
really
to take away a person's rights.
So we need supported decision making.
Correct.
Are there folks in place who can be called on, you know, regularly to provide that support?
Yeah, they're called family and friends.
Okay.
They're the same people that you get support from.
Not everybody has a big, robust family or a functioning family or functioning family.
There are models. One is called the Circle of Support, where you gather professionals and advocates and people you are receiving service from. Sometimes it's important for people who work with people with disabilities to help them identify people who can be supporters and be their friends. Essentially, again, we're putting this label, supported decision making, on the same process we all use to make decisions.
Right, right.
And when you said, how do I consider when I need a guardian and when I don't? I think actually you don't even get to the do I need a guardian question until you've tried everything else and it hasn't worked out.
Okay. And some of the other things I might try would be what?
Powers of attorney, which is
talk to me about that.
A power of attorney is actually come into vogue in about the last 10 years. What it is essentially a supported decision making reduced to a writing that says, I want your help. You're not going to take my rights away.
Right.
I'm going to voluntarily give you certain authority in certain situations. It might just be if I'm not capable of making a decision, if I'm not well, I'm going to give you that authority to do it. I want you to consult with me before you do it. And it can actually list out the exact decisions I want your assistance with. It might be that I can handle everything except money. I don't know what I'm doing with money. I want your help with that. I want your help with medical decisions. We've seen it with the aging population with what we call advanced directives.
Sure.
So it's just an outgrowth of that.
Or people who are in progressively bad health.
And the beauty of a power of attorney is generally the person with a disability is in charge of it. I have chosen the rights I am going to share, and I can take them back. I can rescind that agreement. There's other methods, the advanced directive I mentioned, supported decision making, which I think is the latest and greatest because it's the oldest and most familiar one. We've all done it. That's what we used in Ms. Hatch's case last year, where we showed the judge study after study showing that people with disabilities who have more control over their lives live longer, have better jobs, are better able to resist abuse. I mean, time and time again, we've seen it in the literature, and said, so judge, if you want to protect her, if you want to protect her rights and keep her safe, don't take away her rights. Don't put her under a guardianship. Try this first. And at the risk of getting up on my soapbox, which is someplace I normally live, I think we're going
to... All you Yankee fans are like that.
Right, we preach. 28 championships, we'll do that.
Not much in this decade. I'm just going to leave it at that.
I think we're going to get someplace with guardianship where someday someone's going to go before a judge with a petition for guardianship and say, judge, no one denies this, no one doubts this, let me be this person's guardian. And the judge says, wait a second, what else have you tried? When that happens, I know we'll have gotten somewhere. And day by day, we're getting a little closer, I hope.
Well, how are you going about the business of educating decision makers like judges? Like this television show? Any other methods?
I speak as often as I can. Jenny Hatch and I just keynoted the Jacobus 10 book conference in Baltimore. I spoke to the ACLU in Florida. I'm going to another conference in California. We spread the word, and then we hope for what I call the PERT effect. You'll tell two friends, and they'll tell two friends, and so on, and so on. And the hope is enough people hear this message and say, I haven't tried that. And whenever we talk to parents who say, the teacher told me to get guardianship, we say, well, do you want to make all the decisions? Oh, no, I just want to help. Okay, here's an option. And we've had many people come back to us saying, so-and-so told us about this. And I know that it's taking effect, and I'm hoping it's going to take root.
We have only 5 more minutes. And I'm guessing you have 1 or 2 topics that you're dying to bring up. Hit me.
The Jenny Hatch Justice Project is what we formed after the Jenny Hatch decision. It's designed, and the website is www.jennyhatchjusticeproject.org, to not just be a legal system, because if what we're doing is only assisting people in the legal arena,
right,
and they're fighting guardianship cases, it's too late.
Right.
What we need to do is get information in the hands of parents and professionals and teachers and, yes, judges. So the Jenny Hatch Justice Project was designed to not just represent people with disabilities, although we do that. We sponsor and send out and promote research into supported decision making. We have just applied for a grant from the federal government to do an additional study here in D.C. with the support of the D.C. government. We have a resources section on all kinds of articles and studies on guardianship and self-determination. We have a section where you can find out what the guardianship laws are in your state. And we have a whole section on the Jenny Hatch case. So if you are in a situation where you find yourself facing this kind of case, we'd like to think that it's a pretty good template for what you can do.
Okay. So what's unique to the district? How is the district different or the same as other jurisdictions? And you have a Bar Foundation grant to
right.
do some of this. That's different.
When we look at the larger issue, I think the district is largely the same as other places, although we have supported legislation to change the guardianship laws to at least recognize that supported decision making as an option. If you put those words in a statute, suddenly they have a little more meaning, don't
right,
you think?
Right, sure.
We also did the same for legislation in Virginia with the hopes of, again, raising knowledge about the process.
Right.
The hope is that here in the district, what we can do is model this. We've got support from the D.C. government. We're working with the Developmental Disabilities Administration on a new supported decision-making policy and process and procedures. Same with the D.C. public schools. If we can create this, create a culture where this grows, we can export it. And that's what we do at the Jenny Hatch Justice Project. We export from D.C., and when we go out there, we import to D.C. So my hope is eventually D.C. is going to be just like the rest of the country, which is to say very much in favor of supported decision making.
Very cool. How many people work at Quality Trust?
A couple of dozen. We've got the majority in the monitoring department. I am one of 2 lawyers. Our CEO refers to us as the lean and mean legal division.
Is that Morgan Whitlock?
It is.
Oh, Morgan. Where did she go to law school? Oh, I know Morgan well.
And Morgan is from New England, I believe, unfortunately, a Red Sox fan, but we've done okay.
Just one of the things I love about her.
I love that she's a tremendous attorney.
Yeah. She's a keeper for sure.
If I have anything to say about it, and if I have to write her a check, we're going to make sure that happens.
Oh, good music to my ears. No, she was a very special student. Terrific. She actually trick-or-treated at my house this year, too, so I got to see her. We have excellent taste in trick-or-treating neighborhoods.
That I did not know that, and yeah. I suddenly have something to discuss with her in the office tomorrow.
Okay, we got two more minutes. What's the one thing our audience really needs to hear?
If you are a parent of a person with disabilities, if you are a friend, a family member, an advocate, and you are considering guardianship, one, you're not evil. Okay?
Good
that,
news.
I'm not here to say that you are doing bad by thinking about that. But what I want you to do before you take that step is engage in some supported decision making. Yourself, review, learn, study, talk to people, talk to us, talk to me. We can give you information you need and so that you can make the best possible decision. And I think if you do that, you will find 999 times out of 1,000, guardianship to stay in it.
That's so interesting. I really hadn't heard that before. I thought it was kind of the go-to, this is the way you do this.
You are not alone.
Well, one of the reasons I like to do this show is I always learn as much as our audience does, you know? It's a great opportunity to think about things in a different way and from a different perspective. So you've done a good job raising my consciousness, and I appreciate that.
Thank you so much.
Quality Trust recently received a grant from the District of Columbia Bar Foundation to represent low-income district residents who are facing or in guardianship. To learn more about your rights, guardianship, and supported decision-making, or to request assistance, please call Quality Trust at 202-448-1448 or visit www.jennyhatchjusticeproject.org. Jonathan Martinis can be reached at jmartinis@dcqualitytrust.org or at 202-459-4007. I'm Shelley Broderick. Thanks for watching, and join me next time for more sound advice.